Thank you. My paper is primarily overwhelmingly based upon the field work that I have been doing in the region of Eastern UP and Bihar for the last 5 to 6 years. But of late, this debate about the interplay of Dalit and Muslims from analytical vantage point as well as from the explanatory vantage point has acquired importance in the wake of 4 major incidents, 2 related to, concerning the Muslim community and 2 concerning the Dalit community. So after the unrest in Kashmir and before that the Dadri incident, okay, and apart from that this Una incident and the kind of vulgar uses against Mayawati in Uttar Pradesh, and also because of the forthcoming assembly election, this debate about can there be a Dalit Muslim unity or not, okay, is it possible or not, okay, acquired. Now the point is that, see, whether there can be a Dalit and Muslim unity or not is a normative quest, and it's a normative question, okay. So normatively it's a very progressive quest, and there is a desirability that such 2 oppressed group should come together at a time when the dominant sentiment is that there is a kind of the intolerance is on rise in the society. But this kind of a normative quest also assumes a kind of very rational choice on part of the masses at the bottom, okay, which may, this expectation of a rational choice may not be very reasonable, because the normative concern may contradict or may be oblivious of the ground reality. Now one fact is that yes, there is a Dalit-Muslim clash, and we are getting not only in terms of their political divergences but also in terms of non-political scenario and circumstances, especially in societal realm, in day-to-day life, we are finding that there have been many issues of the clash which can be called as a rising incidence of intra-subaltern conflicts within the religious realm. So Hindu subalterns are primarily having a kind of very acrimonious and tenuous relation with their Muslims. The point is, what is the sociological reality for the descriptive aspect? And second, why is it happening? These 2 things would explain that why is it happening. And then we can see that what are the assumptions that most of the dominant analysis who accept this fact that yes, this kind of a trend of clash between Dalits, lower OBCs and Muslims is on rise, but they are having various explanations, and these explanations are making some of the assumptions. So why I have chosen this region of Eastern UP and Bihar, not because I am just limited in my fieldwork to this region, but also because this is a very interesting region. If you see, I mean, those of you, I mean, who are familiar, but also those of you who are not familiar, if you see the region Eastern UP and Bihar, popularly called as Purvanchal, so there is a river called Ghagra River or Saryu River. I mean, Hyderabad, Saryu, Pari, Brahmins, all these kind of, I mean, you can find the cultural nomenclature. So it divides the Eastern UP into 2 parts. And rivers gives you some kind of a cultural insularity also. Okay, if you can find that, I mean, on a broader level, the larger picture is that you will find that in a popular folk kind of assumption, people always keep on making fun of each other's region. I mean, if you belong to South Bihar, you'll be, I mean, Magadh region will be called as a bit more, I mean, we're not refined, Norths would be considered relatively, and then, so all these kind of, these kind of existing assumptions about each other gives a sense that these 2 regions in Purvanchal, which in popular analytical analysis is considered to be clubbed together, has a very distinct political economy, in terms that north of Ghagra River is Gorakhpur, okay, which is, and from Gorakhpur till the border of Nepal, which is called as Tarai region, okay, this is primarily economically is a agrarian belt. South of Ghagra region is Banaras, Varanasi. Okay, Varanasi, Azamgarh, Mau, which is a sub-region. Economically, it's dominated by the artisans, and primarily the Muslim artisans, especially the weavers. though Muslims on both sides of the rivers belongs to the same caste, predominantly the Ansari Muslims, the Weaver caste Muslims. But occupationally, you will find that predominantly Muslims in north to the river, surrounding the Gorakhpur as the headquarter, are into agrarian relation, while into the south, around the Varanasi, are into the artisan activities. Now, of late you will find that this reason has been in news for multiple and frequent incidents of Dalit-Muslim clash. And the question is that why, despite two different political economy, one primarily artisan economy, other primarily agrarian economy, the southern part surrounding Varanasi having a larger concentration of Muslims, northern part doesn't have more than 10%, especially Gorakhpur. Southern part has a mafia culture coming from the Muslims. You may have heard about the Qaumi Ekta Dal, Mukhtar Ansari. So there have been, Gorakhpur and others have the mafia culture coming primarily from the upper caste Hindu. So Muslims are less than 10% in Gorakhpur. They have never been dominant historically. There is not a mafia like Mukhtar Ansari in that region. Then why the politics of a leader like Yogi Adityanath is succeeding in continuing a very aggressive form of Hindutva? So this is a very intriguing question. And why we are finding the incidents, empirical incidents, that more and more Hindu subaltern caste are participating, and they are not participating. It's not a new phenomenon, because riots has never been, when upper caste never come out of their house, they may be the conspirators. I mean, they may be planning about the riots. Institutional theory says that they are the conspirators, but they never participate, they never become the foot soldiers. Foot soldiers always have been coming from the subaltern caste. So what is the new shift in terms of their participation? So here I'll just invoke some of the observation that I gathered from the field, and I'll just say that primarily the analytic assumption that why this kind of clash between two religious subalterns, Muslim subalterns and Hindu subalterns, primarily Dalits and Muslims, happening are coming from the political scientists and social scientists like Badri Narayan says the process is fascinating Hindutva, okay, and then Ornette Shani in the case of Gujarat also gives that it gives them a kind of a upward mobility. Kancha Ilya says that it's a false consciousness. I mean, they are docile and very vulnerable group who are co-opted. Now, Ajay Gudavarti also has come up with explanation that primarily it's a left out group of the discourse of social justice, okay, who are not the prime beneficiary, primarily are trying to find an alternative. Now, one thing common about all these analyses concerning the Dalit-Muslim clash is the assumption that the agency of the Dalits is very passive. They are sitting there to be co-opted by the Hindutva forces. So fascinating Hindutva says that Hindutva outfits are going into the Dalit hamlets, are manipulating their local gods, they are Hinduizing them, and thereby they are being co-opted into the Hindutva discourse, and then otherwise a very syncretic Sufi and very composite tradition of the Hindu Dalits is being turned and pitted against the Muslims, and this is primary. Now there is a contradiction, because I mean the same Dalit and same Hindu subaltern lower caste agency, when you analyze, and the same set of scholars when they analyze their agency vis-a-vis the social justice discourse, like their participation into the reservation movement and the movement for the proclamation of dignity, then their agency is held as very active and very radical. Okay, so there is a contradiction. You cannot put, okay, the agency, political agency, okay, of the Hindu subalterns, especially Dalits and lower OBCs, as active and radical when they are fighting or engaging with the discourse of social justice, and then the same agency cannot be passive and docile when you find empirical evidences of their interplay with the Hindutva discourse. Okay. So what is happening? And therein comes the field narrative. So I'll just briefly give two field narratives. Primarily one from the Mau, which is a predominantly artisanal town. 60% of the population in Mau town are Muslims, though overall Mau district has just 20% Muslim, but in town they are 60%. And Gorakhpur, which has just 9.1% Muslims, okay, and then we see what has been the responses coming from the Dalits. Now, 2000 Mau has been known for riots, 1969 onwards, and Gorakhpur didn't have any history of counter riots. Now, in Mau, I'll just give that there have been riots, and those riots were, I mean, conforming to the analysis of the Paul Brass institutional theory. There was a religious time. Some procession was going on, there was a differences over, I mean, passing the procession, some petty incidents happened, then there was a rumor spread, and thereafter the clash took place, but administration imposed curfew, and after some time the situation was brought under control. So this was a recurring phenomena happening. You have some incident, but 2005 was different. 2005 was different precisely because riots continued on a massive level for a larger duration. And also because in those riots, it was like Muzaffarnagar, we can call it a Hindu-Muslim riots, but if you just dissect it, you'll find it was primarily a Jat Muslim riots. Who were the one who participated? Why the riot acquired such a notoriety, such a kind of disproportionate violence? Also because from the Hindu side, the caste that was participating was capable of enforcing the damage, had the networking in terms of the Khak network. Similarly, in 2005, if you see the Mau riots, the Mau time, it's very interesting. All the Muslim majority areas in Mau town is shared by Hindu areas, and the one who are living there belong to the Khatiks, Khatik Dalits. And this is the common thing about Gorakhpur also. And this would be the common, I mean, if you do a field work and if you try to find out, you will find that which section of Hindu community shares the social space with the Muslims. You won't find the upper caste. You won't even find the dominant OBCs. Okay. It would be primarily the lower OBCs and the Dalits who may not be the dominant, numerically preponderant Dalits. Like Jatavs won't be sharing much of the space with the Muslims, but you'll find that Parsis, Khatiks. Now, when they are sharing the space, there is a day-to-day normal relation, but also there is a day-to-day petty tensions. Take for example the occupation of the Khatiks in Mau. They are the vegetable and fruit sellers. They put their stalls in front of the markets, okay, the shops primarily owned by the Muslims. So this is one aspect. So also occupationally, Khatiks also have they consume pork, and not only consume pork, but they also have pigs and other animals which they keep for their own economic muscle. So in that sense, what happens, this day-to-day tension, okay, all of a sudden, whenever a rumor spreads, okay, so this day-to-day mundane tension in one kind of exceptional incident, okay, comes together, and thereby this leads to a kind of the Dalits participating in terms of the clash. That is, so the entry of the BJP, RSS or something is not the primary step of the communal discourse. Muzaffarnagar, anybody, you say, they were not the one who came and initiated it. They just jumped when they found a very conducive ambience, and thereafter you find. Now, other thing was that when you talk to these Khatiks, they also have, because apart from the Khatiks in the town area and neighboring area, also find some upper caste Hindus and others. So this is also a very kind of a psychological perception that they happen to be the savior of the Hindu castes. And now, because of the democratic compulsion, BJP or Hindutva outfits are bound to increase their social base. And therein, these are the caste who also happen to be those, I mean, section of the Dalits who have been left out by the social justice discourse. So it's not something that it's a top-down model of Hindutva outfits going and trying to co-opt them. It's a kind of a parity of bargaining. And parity of bargaining joining the Hindutva discourse not because of ideological conviction, but as a calculation, as an instrumental choice. So you find that in one election, You may find that Dalits are voting for BJP. In other election, you will find like after 2014 Bihar and Delhi, they are deserting it. Because it's not a matter of conviction, it's a matter of instrumental calculation. Similarly, this is the same explanation about, now just last point I want to say that when we analyze, we tend to club that there is a Hinduism and its politicization and political usage has converted into Hindutva. Now, we should, on the ground, there is no one Hinduism, there has been Hinduisms, as was emphasized in the morning panel. We forget that there have been many popular folk religions whose social base are coming from the Hindu subaltern caste, including the upper caste also. Now, in Gorakhpur, we may think that Yogi Adityanath, who is a radical, aggressive Hindutva force, represents a Gorakshnath Peet, which belongs to the Nath Sampradaya, which historically was very radical, anti-caste, and he maintains it. I mean, long before Rahul Gandhi's political stunt of visiting in 2009 the Dalit hamlet, everything, as a inheritor of the Nath tradition, not only Dalits are allowed, he goes and have simple dinner with them, simple food with them. Now, this Nath Sampradaya, remember, south of Ghagra River is Banaras, which was known for conservative Hinduism. Okay? And in revolt against that tradition, you see north, okay, you have Nath Sampradaya, Gorakshnath Peet, which happens to be the largest institution. Now, what happens? Now, this Gorakshnath Peet, what was the need to establish Hindu Yuva Vahini when you have VHP, Bajrang Dal, RSS? Why in Gorakhpur you don't need? Muslims are just 9%. Why you are needing? Now this is precisely because you see there is an intra-Hindutva rivalry that we don't acknowledge. And this rivalry is so much so that whenever a small petty incident happens, the office bearer of these outfits at local levels have a competition to emerge as the better champion of the Hindutva cause. And therefore, you see, it's very, very, very competitive, leading to one small incident being blown out of proportion. And thereby, you see, there has been a trend of communalization of day-to-day life. Why? Because nobody wants to be left behind. And it is precisely this kind of a trend when we find that this increasing trend of primarily Hindu, Dalit and Muslim clash is coming from one, the economic and political economy of Dalits sharing the space with the Muslims, which manifests in terms of the frequent clash, and second, the kind of the cultural aspiration in the sense because those Dalits who are sharing their space are also happen to be the one who have been left behind. Okay, in terms of the social justice discourse. So Hindutva gives them a chance. So it's a bargaining and negotiation at par with each other, rather than, as Badrinath and others says, that the outfit goes them and just somehow manipulate their agency and their thoughts and their spirits. Thank you.
I think it was very insightful presentation, because I think it was M.N. Srinivas who said that macro level studies provide a perspective, micro level studies provide an insight. I think Sajjan's presentation is basically providing us an insight into what dynamics operate and how they manifest at a macro level. But I think this macro micro interconnection is perhaps the need of the hour to understand how forces are working at the grassroots level, and how the tensions build up in everyday relation, in a small, you know, business, small opportunities, shrinking opportunities, claims and counterclaims, you know, they also contribute to the process. And communal forces, how they cash these everyday tensions, I think is something very important and very interesting. When I was doing a study in Telangana, because their relations are slightly different, but I went to a village to study, and then I asked the Dalits to identify five poorest of the poor families. Just I want to see the magnitude of poverty and whom do people consider as the poorest. And the Dalits sat and identified five families, and the first family that they have taken is a Muslim family. The couple were not there, but there was a newspaper, you know, I mean, for the hut, they don't have a cover. But the Dalits were describing their poverty in such a way, sir, they forgo food, you know, they sometimes are hungry. Now this secular relation, you know, at one level. But when it comes to a little bit of, you know, opportunities, claims and counterclaims, then there is a tension, right, at a macro level. And how the macro level Hindutva forces are cashing on the, you know, what's happening at micro level, I think something very important for us to study if we have to really negotiate with the, you know, with the way the, you know, dynamics of communalism are operating. I think we are already running short of time, I don't know. But anyway, we'll take about 15 minutes.